You can't get maximum flavor without fresh ingredients, and it doesn't get any better than catching my own fish. And apparently to my producers, that means getting on a seaplane. Here we go.
I'm Adrienne Calvo, chef, author, traveler, and restaurateur. I've been cooking for as long as I can remember, and along the way, I created a little something called maximum flavor. That's my style of cooking. I want to activate all parts of the palate: sweet, sour, salty, bitter, and spicy, sending delicious endorphins to your brain. And now, I'm on the hunt for inspiration. Join me as I head out in search of maximum flavor.
Welcome to New Orleans. How do you say it? New Orleans, Nolens, New Orleans? It's the birthplace of over-the-top deliciousness, insatiableness, secrets, and speakeasies. What died didn't stay dead here. It's very much alive in the architecture, the sounds, the flavors. This town knows how to tease you and please you.
The city's African, Spanish, and French influence allows for creamy, spicy, delicious food, which screams maximum flavor. I'm here with my corporate executive chef, Egg, on the hunt for some oyster inspiration. But don't worry, I won't leave out all the good stops along the way.
You can't visit New Orleans without having an iconic beignet here at Café du Monde. These are fried bits of deliciousness, pillowy, doughy. It's what dreams are made of. Now, between the famous green awning, warm café au lait, and people watching, Café du Monde is a must-do when you visit New Orleans.
Now that I'm fully caffeinated, I'm ready to learn a bit about the charm that makes New Orleans a destination attracting millions every year. I'm on my way to the old Absinthe House to learn all their secrets.
Can you tell me about the importance of the old Absinthe House in New Orleans? And actually, the importance of it as a bar in general in America. Tell me about like that history, how it's important to continue that legacy and continue telling these stories.
The Absinthe House has been around since 1807, and it's been known and loved by generations of New Orleanians and people from all over the world, like we say Hemingway, Mark Twain, Edgar Allan Poe, Sarah Bernhardt drank here, presidents have drunk here. I mean, people come in and they like it that the bartenders have been here a long time. They go, "Do you remember my father?" And we have a whole wall of pictures of people who used to drink here who have passed away. We put their obituaries up on the wall.
Who's the most famous ghost that's haunting us now?
Oscar Wilde.
Oscar Wilde? No. Really?
He drank here.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I don't know if he's a ghost, but he drank here. Mark Twain drank here.
Okay, so Hemingway writers. As well. Hemingway?
Yes.
Okay, mm-hmm. I wonder if any of their literary works were inspired by some absinthe here.
There is writings where the Absinthe House is being talked about. You know, it's one of those places that, you know, artists like back in the days used to come and relax and just like drink that absinthe because it opens up your mind and your artistic side of it.
It's an experience. Yeah.
The more absinthe you drink, the clearer you get.
Oh my gosh.
It's not like more lucid. It's not like tequila where you black out.
Mm-hmm.
It's like you're more clear. And you can still think and process your thoughts and emotions.
Okay.
That's why artists liked it.
When people say, "I've never had absinthe before, you know, what should I expect?" I say, "Well, first of all, you know, just put it on the tip of your tongue and just let your palate just like bring it in, you know, so that you like."
My first sip, my tongue felt a little bit numb. Is that normal?
That is normal.
Yeah,
that's the first sign of the green fairy is approaching.
Coming.
It's coming in, yeah. Tinkerbell, is that you? I want to know what you guys make. How do you use absinthe?
The traditional way with the drips and the whole experience. I always tell people, have the absinthe the traditional way first.
Mm-hmm.
So that you know that you have experienced it that way. But once you've experienced it that way, you can mix absinthe with champagne. There's the Hemingway. Death in the Afternoon is also made with champagne.
Death in the Afternoon, that's what happened to me yesterday.
If somebody doesn't like the absinthe, I just take the absinthe and anything citrusy will actually die down. It'll work really good. If you have like, you know, pineapple, lemon, lime, you can just mix them around. Cherries, you muddle them and like it comes with a great, great punch.
What's that?
That is one of our oldest water drippers. They're called the fountains. And that's from the 1850s, 1870s. It was supposed to end up in the opera house down the street, but somehow it ended up here at the Absinthe House. During Prohibition, those fountains and the actual bar. This is the original absinthe bar from the 1800s, 1900s.
So there's a good chance Ernest Hemingway, one of my favorite writers of all time,
touched this bar.
Okay.
As he was thinking about writing his next novel.
Gosh. All right. I like this.
Farewell to Arms.
Yeah.
The character of New Orleans definitely comes from its history. And speaking of history, I'm on my way to Antoine's, restaurant license number one in the U.S., to meet up with its owner, Lisa.
The restaurant started, Antoine came from France, and he kind of said, gosh, okay, I want to do something different. He came here, and he worked a couple places, and he said, I'm going to open up my own place. We're going to get hungry here in a moment. I'm going to stop talking. Okay, so oysters Rockefeller. The ugliest dish in the world is what they are. When it was invented was that there was no such thing as a baked oysters. Oysters were served fried or like as a protein in something. So they couldn't get escargot. They had all these oysters and they said, why don't we put a sauce on an oyster and bake it just like we would escargot because we have so many of them. So that was invented as that sauce, and its sauce is, it was so rich in flavor that they called it Rockefeller. The recipe starts with 40 pounds of butter. What's interesting about the legacy of oysters Rockefeller is that was kind of the first baked oyster. So I'm sure you've had charbroiled oysters here, and I think that was kind of the precipice for it.
Here we have my favorite of the cooked oysters, the charbroiled oyster. Right here, let's give this a try. So much garlic. It's so good that I'm gonna grab a piece of bread and I wanna like slurp up what's in the shell. That's how good this is. Wow. And I think like that juice from the oyster is like giving us a little bit of umami. So one of the best things about traveling is the things that you learn along the way. And today, as we're sitting here at Antoine's, we learned that the Chef de Cuisine developed the Baked Alaska right here, and it was actually developed after the U.S. bought Alaska. So here's to Baked Alaska. Cheers. This is great. This is what everybody wants in a dessert. You have ice cream, you have cake, you have meringue. What I think is so interesting about this is that this is uniformly toasted. It's perfect.
All I can say is wow. New Orleans is full of surprises, but I'm still in search of more delicious oysters. So off we go to another iconic spot in the Big Easy, Drago's, to have some charbroiled oysters.
So tell me a little bit about Drago's. Like, well, you were telling me that it's your father's name.
My dad and mom started this restaurant in 1969. We had one restaurant then, and it was kind of like that little back corner back there. And this is our original restaurant. It's grown a few times since then. We've had a few renovations and expansions and always trying to do stuff. From there, we opened up Jackson, Mississippi. Then we went to Lafayette. Then we went to Baton Rouge. We have the Hilton location. That Hilton location, for a while before COVID, was the highest grossing, most profitable restaurant in the Hilton chain of restaurants worldwide.
Wow.
So that's something we're pretty proud of for a mom and pop restaurant.
Your site says that you guys put oyster bars on the map. Like, tell me about it.
About 30 years ago, I was sitting in the kitchen, I'm playing, and I was thinking, what if I took this oyster and put it on the barbecue grill and used this one sauce that we used to put on fish and put them together, and that what if turned into this. And
really?
And we're very proud of it. And it's a cool thing for me when I travel and I get to go to other places or other cities and I see charbroiled oysters on their menu thinking, you know, wow, that's my idea.
And, so you're like the creator
of
the charbroiled oyster.
Uh-huh.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. So, and I'm like your biggest fan.
So we do
these now at our restaurant in Miami. So
I can't wait to come down there and try it.
Oh my gosh.
And I love it. I tell people, you put butter, garlic, parsley, and cheese, you put them on a flip-flop, it's going to be delicious.
That is true.
A beautiful Louisiana oyster.
So oysters are a big deal here in New Orleans. Why do you think that is?
Well, it's simple. Louisiana oysters. Our oysters are without a doubt the best, and there's a reason for that. It's not just simply saying, hey, we're the best. Actually, where the Mississippi River meets the Gulf of Mexico is where most of Louisiana oysters come from, and there's a constant mixing of fresh water with the salt water, and it happens on a daily basis. So our oysters get all the nutrients from the fresh water in the morning, let's say, and then like in the afternoon, we'll get all the nutrients from the salt water. So that combination of nutrients is what makes our oysters different. That's what makes them so good. And then you take a bunch of Louisiana cooks that have generations and generations of styles of cooking and spices and mixing them together. And like Chef Paul used to say, make magic in your mouth. Great oysters, great cooking styles, great flavors. And that's what makes our oysters better than all.
I have to try this now.
Go ahead, dig in. That's what the fork's for. How's that? First off, it's hot.
This might be the best one I've ever had.
Well, we like to advertise and say that this is the single best bite of food in town.
You need to try this. I agree. I have to take a dip in this butter.
And oh, yeah.
To prevent myself from taking a bath in this butter. I have to thank you for your time and for keeping this alive.
Oh.
When your parents started, what you created. I mean, this is just amazing. And I feel like iconic dishes with places, they should be as good as this. I mean, they should, when you put that first bite in your mouth, they should make you lean back in your chair and just take a breath.
Well,
this
I gotta tell
magical.
You, for me to think that I had something to do with oysters that is, you know, kind of affecting the market where this was not on any menus, and now you're saying it's even in your restaurant in
yes.
Miami.
Yes.
And it's something that I'm incredibly proud of. And,
well, thank you. I mean, thank you for this.
It's a neat feeling.
So I've been to New Orleans many times before, but this time I wanted to do something unlike anything I've ever done here. This time we're going fishing, but not just any fishing. We're taking a seaplane to Chandelier Islands to catch some redfish.
And we're attempting to catch some fish. I say attempting because I don't know how good we're gonna be, but it's aspirational. You think we got a good chance of catching some fish?
Oh yeah, we're gonna catch some fish. It's too small?
Yeah, it's too small, you can't keep it.
Yeah.
So here's the deal. We tasted our way through New Orleans, and when we got back, I wanted to create something unique that paid homage to the original. And here it is. Cajun garlic butter, the right amount of Parmesan cheese and parsley, and the most important ingredient, a high-quality oyster. Charbroiled oysters, maximum flavor style. What do you think, team?
Oh my God, it's amazing.
Well, thanks for following the journey. If you liked our adventure, hit the subscribe button.